Now, verse 6, for this cause was the gospel preached also to them that are dead, that they might be judged according to man in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. Now, God wants the gospel preached to all men. And if they don't hear the gospel and don't respond to the gospel, he makes it very clear that they are already dead in trespasses and sins, and they will be judged as men in the flesh. But if they accept Christ, they can live according to God in the Spirit. And that is the thing the Lord Jesus made very clear. In John 5:24, he says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word, believeth on him that sent me, hath everlasting life, shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life." He was in a state, you see, of death. And he further amplified that at the time of the death of Lazarus, over in the 11th chapter of John, at verse 25, Jesus said unto her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this?" In other words, you and I are dead in trespasses and sins, and that's what Paul meant in the 2nd chapter of Ephesians when he said, "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins." We're spiritually dead. Now, in time past, Paul says, we walked according to the course of the world, and we were fulfilling the lusts of the flesh. Now, that's exactly what Peter is saying here, that the gospel is being preached. And when the gospel is preached, two things happen. Some accept it. And if they accept it, they're going to live for God and live throughout eternity. And the others, they are men that are dead in sins, and they are dead to God throughout eternity. That is, no relation to him whatsoever. This is a tremendous statement that he's making here. Now, he moves on down in verse 7, "But the end of all things is at hand." That has been true from the day that he went back to heaven. Paul could say that the coming of Christ was imminent, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing. That is the rapture of the church. And he says here, the end of all things is at hand. God's going to bring this world to a standstill one of these days. While he judges it, he'll take his own out of the world. There'll be a lot of things to straighten up in the lives of believers. They go before the judgment seat of Christ, not regarding salvation, but regarding rewards, regarding their life that they live for God. That's another reason that we should live for God down here, because we are coming up for judgment. He says, "Be ye therefore sober-minded." And I'm glad that the New Scofield Bible has put that in, sober-minded. Peter uses this expression a great deal. And when he uses it, he means actually, be ye therefore intelligent. Be an intelligent Christian. Now, an intelligent Christian is one that will know the Bible. That is, know it the best he can. I've already made the confession on this program that I marvel at my ignorance of the Word of God. And the more I study it, the more ignorant I become. I see how little I really know about the Word of God. But friends, an intelligent, sober-minded Christian is going to know the Word of God. Be something radically wrong. And not only that, he's to be intelligent in an evil world. The Lord Jesus said, "Be wise as serpents, harmless as doves." But you better have the wisdom of a serpent today. If you don't, another snake around the corner is going to bite you. I can assure you that. "Be therefore sober-minded and watch unto prayer." In other words, prayer should have that anticipation in it, that expectation in it of the coming of Christ. Oh, our dead prayer meetings today, because we're not looking for him. He's the living Christ, and we ought to talk to him now, and we're going to talk to him hereafter, and he's going to talk to us. That's the one I'm not so sure I'm looking forward to.